Hello, and welcome to Spotting Session, the composer as auteur. Well, that music was suspenseful, wasn't it? That's because today we're discussing Berrnard Hermann. As I discussed in the introduction, this series will be exploring whether a film composer can be considered an auteur and the implications of that. One question that becomes central to this conversation is that of composer-director collaboration. The crucial question is whether it requires a long-term collaboration to reach this ideal. Claudia Gorbman argued in her influential work, Auteur Music, that director-composer collaborations gave consistency to groups of work, and that as the auteur director has placed a premium on asserting control of the texture, rhythm, and tonality of his or her work, that music is an essential aspect of auteurism. Thus, is the authorship of the music one credited to the director or the composer? Does it require long-term collaboration with an auteur director to achieve fame? Is their sound famous because of the director, or vice versa? Gorbin argues that it is the director who holds authorship, but I beg to differ. Collaboration with a well-known director may be a means of achieving renown, but this calls into question the authorial sound. To answer this question, today we'll be looking at the works of Berrnard Hermann, a film composer who some theorists have argued is the most influential film composer. You may think you've never heard of him, but what about this? That cue, made famous from Psycho, has become a cultural icon. It is used in tons of media to call on the ideas of murder, suspense, and fear. It is not the image of Psycho that conjures these feelings, but the sound. Hermann's career in Hollywood spanned several decades. His first film was Citizen Kane. Let's really absorb that. His first film was Citizen Kane. One of his last films was Taxi Driver. Wow. However, he is arguably most well known for his scores for Alfred Hitchcock. Andy Hill states in his book, Scoring the Screen, that Berrnard Hermann created for Alfred Hitchcock a music of the irrational. Hitchcock is a perfect case study for this piece, as he is often viewed as the quintessential auteur, with complete control over every aspect of his films. However, is this really the case? Hermann once said that, quote, Orson Welles is the only director who has any musical cultural background. All the other directors I worked with haven't the temerity to tell me anything about music. Hitchcock left it completely to me. So, let's look at one of their most famous collaborations and the score that Hill claims changed the face of film scoring, Vertigo. The score of Vertigo is one that film music scholars view as essential reading, in a sense. Hermann took the film language established by his predecessors and developed it in a way that has become fundamental in film scoring. There are two main aspects of this. Firstly, film scoring is an incredibly intertextual art form. It is full of quotations from other pieces and variations on themes that we know, also what Hill calls the familiar-unfamiliar. Hill asserts that in writing the score for Vertigo, Hermann knew that the best score for the story had already been written in the form of Wagner's Tristan und Isolde. The story of this opera is incredibly similar to that of Vertigo, but especially in its musicality. The first chord, known as the Tristan chord, is known for its significance and move towards dissonance. Let's listen. Now, let's listen to something else. That was the sleep cue from Vertigo that occurs just as Madeline wakes up at Scotty's house after jumping in the San Francisco Bay. It is the same exact F half-diminished seventh chord that opens Tristan. Hermann also invokes Wagner's Liebestod motif, the love-death theme from Tristan, in his Scene d'Amour. By infusing his score with these intertextual references, Hill argues that Hermann showed himself to be the first great film composer to grasp the fact that the power of cinema lies in its ability to resonate with shared experiences, memories, even subconscious content. But Hermann is not just copying Wagner, he's taking the dissonant mode of Tristan and creating variation through different voicing, mode mixing, and more. Thus, to create a sense of uneasiness that is critical to any suspenseful mood, Hermann used dissonant harmonies that eschew comforting resolutions. What made Hermann a master at manipulating audiences is the virtuosity at using nagging ostinatos and inconclusive harmonies to tweak their expectations, while rarely providing the melodic reassurance. His use of voicing and mode mixing have become hallmarks of not just his film scores, but of film music. Think about the Psycho strings I played earlier in the episode. Violins have become so heavily associated with suspense and murder that you can find them across hundreds of film scores for horror films, even today. For example, Hermann's use of minor harmonies with root movement by thirds around a common tone is referred to as the Hermann effect. Hill draws a clear line starting with Spellbound and Vertigo to Basic Instinct and then to 2014's Under the Skin by Micah Levy. Despite Levy's score using a hybrid of orchestral performance and electronic sound, notably synth, to capture the extraterrestrial feeling of the film, if you reduce it just to its basic melody, it plays into the same minor harmonies and dissonance as the Hermann effect does, playing on what Hill coins the familiar, unfamiliar in film scoring. But as we've seen, the use of the familiar, unfamiliar is not new. It goes all the way back to the beginnings of film scoring, drawing upon Wagner and other romantic composers. One could argue that Hermann's voicing and mode mixing is unique to his collaborations with Hitchcock, as he was creating that sound for Hitchcock. Well, who better to contrast with than the auteur theory's creator and Hitchcock's greatest champion, François Truffaut? When Truffaut set out to make Fahrenheit 451, he wanted his futuristic vision to be accompanied by music of clarity and almost neoclassical simplicity, but struggled to find composers who could give him this sound. It was actually Ray Bradbury who suggested Hermann, knowing how much Truffaut looked up to Hitchcock. It just so happened that Hermann had just cut ties with Hitchcock for throwing out his score for Torn Curtain, and so Hermann came aboard. In Fahrenheit 451, Hermann takes his signature sound and adapts it to create the sound of the 21st century. He again showed his mastery of voicing, similar to Psycho, only having a string orchestration, by having a very limited number of instruments. Only string instruments, harp, xylophone, vibraphone, marimba, and glockenspiel. Especially those latter instruments were not common in the world of sci-fi film scoring, with other composers focusing on the theremin, organ, and such. An example of the effect of this voicing comes in the fire truck cue. From Spencer, Hermann's mechanical, repetitive music for the fire truck sequence features xylophones. Truffaut deemed them too comical, insisted they be removed during the recording process. Hermann got the message, but refused to remove the xylophones. By leaving the xylophone in, Hermann instilled childishness in the music, which served to reinforce the notion that a society that condones book burning is irresponsible and senseless. Let's listen to another cue. Does this sound familiar to you? In many ways, apart from voicing, this cue, the flamethrower, is very similar to the main theme of Vertigo. What Hermann is doing is taking his familiar, melodic, and dissonant elements and adapting them for his sounds needed in Fahrenheit 451. He has evoked the familiar unfamiliar. Although we're reaching the end of our time, this conversation is definitely not over. This all raises the question of authorship. Is Hermann less of an author, given his quotations of Wagner? I would argue no. He is rather displaying his mastery of playing on collective memory and semiotics. He understood the cultural significance of romantic music, and harnessed that to create a film language of the irrational, as Hill calls it. By all accounts, Hermann should be considered an auteur. He created a distinct style that is recognizable across his oeuvre, not just his works with Hitchcock, as we have shown. I would go so far as to say that Hermann did not need Hitchcock, but Hitchcock needed Hermann. Music is able to conjure visuals in a way that is not possible in the reverse. When shows like The Simpsons use cues from North by Northwest or Psycho, we know what is intended, and those images are brought back into our memories. Hermann has helped to keep Hitchcock relevant, and the similar style across his oeuvre is also further proof that Hitchcock was not the completely controlling auteur he's been painted to be. So we've shown that film composers, on their own, have all the traits and mastery to be considered an auteur. But now we have to ask, should they be? What are the implications of this? We'll talk about that more next time. Thank you for listening.